In today's video, we're going to talk about biology and life. Since we're at the start of our biology course, it would be a good time to talk a bit about what biology is, and that includes also discussing science. So biology is the scientific study of life. And so what does it mean that biology is a science? Well, a science is a systematic method of inquiry. What that means is that science is really a way of asking questions and then answering those questions. This is done through a series of steps known as the scientific method of inquiry. Scientific knowledge and discoveries are obtained by following these steps. And this is true for all different aspects of science. The scientific method is how we go about performing science. Now, depending on which textbooks you use, sometimes it will list 4 different steps to the scientific method, sometimes it'll list 5 different steps, but regardless of the number of steps, it always needs to start with observation. Sometimes scientists may spend their entire career simply making observations and recording them and sharing those observations with others, and that's a great way to build foundational understanding in a field. Observation really is the key to making something a science. And as we'll learn, there are many ways to make observations. Most common would be using our own senses. Our sense of sight, our sense of hearing, our sense of touch. Yet, we do also have specialized detection equipment, which allows us to extend our senses beyond what we would normally be able to detect. Whether these are microscopes, which allow us to see very small objects, or telescopes, which allow us to see very distant objects, or even different pieces of equipment that can allow us to maybe visualize something that we wouldn't normally be able to see, such as electrical currents or magnetic fields. These all allow us to make observations. Now, these observations typically lead us to ask the question, why? By observing nature and the natural world, we develop questions. These questions may have to do with common occurrences or events, such as, usually when I go outside, the sky is blue. Why? Or when I see groups of birds migrating overhead, they're usually flying in a V-shape. Why? These common occurrences can lead to questions. But suppose instead maybe you went out to Lake Mead or some other body of water, and instead of seeing the lake in its usual state, you go there and the surface of the lake is just covered with dead fish, tens of thousands of dead fish. That would be out of the ordinary. That'd be different. That would inspire you to ask the question, why? So questions can sometimes be inspired by events that seem different or out of the ordinary. Regardless of the origin of the question, once you have that question of why, our next step is to give it our best shot, attempt to answer the question based on what we know. So once we have a question, the next step is to make a hypothesis. So what is that? What is a hypothesis? Well, a hypothesis, first off, it's an answer to the question that came from our observation. Now, you may have often heard of a hypothesis described as an educated guess, and that's a good definition of it. But one thing that's included within this definition that you may not always be aware of is that hypothesis is based on knowledge you already have. Once you have the hypothesis, you can then make predictions. So predictions are what we will end up testing using experiments. So predictions, they're based on the hypothesis, and the prediction will often sound something like this. If our hypothesis is correct, then we would expect to see this certain result when a particular event happens. These predictions then need to be tested to see if our hypothesis is correct. So testing of predictions happens in the experiment phase. Experiments are designed to test the predictions which were based on our hypotheses. Now, a few things about experiments. First off, they are not accidents. While it's true, accidents can sometimes lead to new observations, and that in turn can lead to new questions, an experiment itself is designed. An experiment has a purpose, and the purpose of that experiment is to test the prediction. Good predictions lead to good experiments. So, we've performed our experiment, then what? Well, upon completing the experiment, our prediction is either going to be proven correct or incorrect. If our prediction is supported, we then typically make another prediction. Using our same hypothesis and plan another experiment. Often our goal is to get as much supporting information as possible so that we can know our hypothesis is on the right track. However, if our prediction is not met in that experiment, if we are incorrect, we need to rethink our hypothesis. Now, at first, this might sound really bad. It's like, if we fail in our experiment, we're back with nothing. But the thing is, it's not that we have nothing. We now have new information. We have new knowledge. We can go back to that original problem and approach it with this new information that we've gained and come up with a better, more accurate answer to that question. This is the scientific method. So, looking at an example of this, imagine you have a flashlight and you go to turn that flashlight on, you flip the switch, and nothing happens. There's no light. And you say, why doesn't my flashlight work? That's the question. Why? Your hypothesis is then based on your knowledge and experience of flashlights. You know, well, they run on batteries, so maybe something is up with the batteries. Your prediction then becomes, if I replace these batteries with new fresh batteries, then I think the flashlight will work. And that actually then becomes your experiment. Do just that. Take out the old batteries, put in new fresh batteries, and flip the switch. One of two things is going to happen. Either the flashlight will turn on, or it won't. Now, if you flip that switch and the flashlight turns on, then your prediction and your hypothesis were supported. Something was up with those batteries. Now, you could do further testing if you wanted to see if all of the batteries were dead or just some of the batteries were dead, but you have new avenues you could pursue, but regardless, your flashlight is working. But let's say instead of that other situation, you put in new fresh batteries, you flip the switch, and still nothing. Nothing happens. Well, at this point, you can rule out the batteries as being the reason for the flashlight not working. Maybe the switch itself is broken. Maybe the light bulb is burned out. These are other things you can then go on to test to figure out what's necessary to get that flashlight working again. Now, that last example maybe seemed a little artificial or not really biology-focused, but we use the scientific method in our daily lives all the time. So a slightly more biologically relevant example. Remember a little earlier when I talked about going out to a lake or a river and seeing the surface of that body of water just covered with dead fish? Well, those sorts of things can happen and have happened in the past. We call these massive fish die-offs, and in the early 1990s, there were massive fish die-offs in many bodies of water in the North Carolina area. Now, these fish that were dead, it's not just that they were dead, but they had these big open sores on their side, and they would die off in mass numbers. Now, many different people saw these dead fish, and they all had the same question. Why? What happened? What caused these fish to be killed? And there were many different hypotheses. Some people blamed pollution, some people blamed birds, some people blamed insect parasites. Well, there's a group of researchers who are familiar with the fish in that area, Dr. Burkholder and her associates, they had, in their own laboratory setting, seen fish die in this way previously, and they had tracked it down to a specific type of microorganism called a protist. So based on the experiences and the knowledge of her and her fellow researchers, they came up with a different hypothesis, that these fish were dying off because of the protists. Now, if these fish are being killed by protists, then we'd expect to see increases in the number of protists at the time of the fish die-off. We would also expect that if we added these protists to an aquarium containing the same type of fish, well, it would cause death for those fish as well. These are predictions. Based on their hypothesis that it was these protists causing the fish to die off, that they could actually test. They could perform these experiments and look at the results. And sure enough, they did find that it was in fact protists leading off to those fish die-offs. Now that then opened up a whole another series of questions. Why is it that the protists started killing off the fish? Were they protists always there? Were they newly introduced? Why is it that now things are different than they were before? And each of these questions can be approached using that scientific method. Now that we've talked a bit about the scientific method and how it works, it's time to discuss just a bit the limits to the scientific method. Now, the scientific method is great for studying the natural world, for studying things that are observable and repeatable and testable. But there are many aspects of life and society in which scientific analysis is not the best way of answering those questions. For instance, science cannot make moral judgments. Science can't say whether something is morally right or morally wrong. That's in the realm of philosophy and sociology. That's not in the realm of natural science. Also, science cannot prove or disprove faith-based beliefs. If we're talking about something that cannot be repeated, cannot be observed, cannot occur again, that's sort of outside of the realm of science. Another thing that science doesn't have a say on is personal aesthetic values. Science can't say which style of music is the best. Science can't say whether a picture is beautiful or ugly. Those are in the realms of personal aesthetic values. Now, a friend of mine posted this picture a while ago. Science can tell you how to clone a Tyrannosaurus Rex, whereas humanities can tell you why this might be a bad idea. Now, it's not saying that all science is foolhardy or shouldn't be attempted, but don't leave it to science whether something should happen or not. Science just tells us if something can happen. Thank you all very much for your attention. I'll see you in the next video.